So Sylvie runs a blogging post that she does concerning her time here in Thailand, and I've had a couple of contacts with Sylvie helping the guys from Wumrikun when we first were setting up the websites and things for them, and through her blogs I've actually learned a lot. Even though I've been training a long time, the way she breaks down videos, breaks down techniques of her training and things, it's amazing. So I'm hoping that after today, those who haven't already got onto her site and seen that sort of stuff can get on there and see what she's doing. So, Sylvie, how did you first come across to Thailand, and what made you decide to spend so much time here?
Okay, firstly, sorry, I'm incredibly shy, so if I'm not projecting, just tell me, because I write, I don't talk. So the first time we came to Thailand was actually because my trainer in America, who was like 73, 74 years old at the time, had angioplasty, and so this sudden realization that he was not going to be there forever made me feel like I owed it to him to understand the fundamentals more than I had. He had this like PhD level of teaching me stuff, and I just had absolutely none of the foundations that went underneath that. So we came out to Thailand for the first time in 2010 for just a 10-week trip. At my size, shockingly, I'm not an average American size, and it's hard to find people to fight. So here I fight people above my weight, and in America I fought people above my weight. But I really just wanted to get more experience, and coming to Thailand I knew I could do that. So the first time we came for 10 weeks and I had 3 fights. I trained up at Lana Muay Thai in Chiang Mai and then came down to Sasaprapa in Bangkok. And once you experience Thailand for the first time, it just becomes the how do I come back here. So it took us 2 years to save up, and we thought we were just going to come out for about 6 months to a year. We didn't know how long we could afford it or how long we could stay, and we just passed our 5-year anniversary. So it kind of gradually took over my life. I didn't have a moment where I'm like, I'm going to go for 5 years and get 200 fights. Like, you don't think of that right at first. It kind of just, like a snake, slowly swallowed more and more of my life until this is what I do, and it's an obsession. So
when you first decided to try and be here a bit longer, you sort of set yourself that goal of 100 fights.
First it was 50.
50.
Because that seems crazy.
And how long did it take you to get up to that?
50 fights was a year and a half, maybe?
Yeah, maybe.
A year and a half. I fight a lot. And then once we hit 50, it was like, it's already rolling, so you just keep going with it. And so 50 seemed like this crazy landmark, but once we passed it, 100 seemed really achievable. And I'm now at 183, so 200 is going to happen as long as I don't keel over or die.
Sylvie.
So the reason we came to Chiang Mai in the first place was there was this girl also named Sylvie, also my size, from Canada. And she stayed in Thailand for 5 years and got 50 fights, which seemed like the craziest thing. But I knew that because she had done it, I could do it. And so she was the inspiration to come out. I didn't know it took her 5 years to do it. But basically just using her as an example of that there is a possibility, I followed the idea of that with Sylvie and then kind of just kept rolling with it. So I guess I'm Sylvie 2.0, and now people are going to Thailand for the other Sylvie. Yeah.
And what I really like about what you've done is that you've not just come to fight, you've come to explore the different range of skills and things as well, and to really improve your whole game overall, and then share that with everyone. So you could be really controlling of it and not wanting to get that information out, but you've been really free of doing it, and it's obviously taken time too, because when you feel stuff happening and then you go back and watch it, and then you've got to try and record over your voiceover of explanation, and I know that's not just as simple as people think. It's really time consuming, and when you're already tired from training a couple of times a day and you're in for fights. So at what point did you decide that that was going to be a part of the model of how you were going to try and stay here?
I think, again, it's something that's just been kind of an evolution to what I'm doing. So at first I was just writing as much as I could and trying to express these things, but when I was, from day one, when I started training with Master K in his basement in New Jersey, we wanted to film it because not only is it something that I could watch again and kind of really pick apart what he was teaching me, but not everyone gets to train with him. So just putting it on YouTube, thinking that like 4 people were gonna watch it, and now there's like a million views or something like that. Just sharing it as, why would you want to keep that for yourself only? Like, I don't get anything out of knowing something that someone else doesn't know. I get something out of being better at it than someone. And you do that by repeating it, not by hiding it or something. So I think that just the gradual evolution of putting things up, and then the more I understood, the more I was able to comment on it. And then now that I'm able to train with legends, being able to kind of dissect what that experience was like or what they're trying to show me. And because from the very beginning I was showing long form videos, I don't edit my videos to be like highlight reels. I show myself being really shitty at the techniques for like 20 minutes at a time. I think that that helped develop the analysis and critique that I can put into these training videos of not being able to do it correctly, but seeing the difference between what the legend is doing and what I'm doing. Because it's not actually like the training montage in kung fu movies. You actually yeah. have to put in the work. So
It doesn't happen overnight.
No, still battle a lot of these things.
So Sylvie does something that we sometimes feel it's frowned upon, and that is going to seek different trainers for different things. And I know as a trainer, I haven't got skills in all areas and I can't cover all things. And what I found great is that you've been able to do that, and you've still got your base trainers that you're spending most of your time with, but you've been really comfortable in going to find these legends in something to go and work with, and they've generally given you their stuff, and they see that you're serious and you want to train. Has that been something you've found is easy to do, or was it a struggle at first?
For the most part, the trainers that have been my foundational trainers have given me their blessing to go out and learn from other people because they know what that is. Occasionally, I have had trainers who are very possessive and don't like that idea, and generally those relationships fall apart kind of naturally. But I think that being respectful in each space and in the relationships as a whole, I never go to a trainer and when they're showing me something, say, but my other trainer says this. It's like, if you're going to have more than one boyfriend, you don't talk about them to each other. You know? Let it roll. And for the most part, when I'm training with these legends, the trainers that I have similar techniques are really not as different as people think they are. It's putting it in the context of an overall system that makes them really unique. So people will ask me, don't you get confused when one person has you, you know, doing something like this and the other person has you stepping over and doing it like that? And it's, I recently wrote a blog post that it's not as hard as it seems. It's like remembering not to swear in front of your grandma, but talking a lot of shit with your brother. Like, it's contextual. So I can change how I'm doing a technique for one person versus another because it's within that system. If you're just trying to, like, I only heard that you're supposed to lean back on knees so I can never learn to not lean back on knees, it means you're missing the bigger picture of these things. And overall, most of the techniques are really, really similar. It's just one person. When you see a fighter like San Chai, his technique is actually not super special. It's everything around the technique. It's his, like, fuck you attitude around everything that makes him look so amazing. He's really just punching and kicking exactly the same way that his opponent is. He's just way more comfortable in it than most of his people.
I reckon that's a really mature attitude within martial arts, and particularly within Thai. Often when we're training people as trainers, we show a technique, and then if they don't continue training, they think that that's what we meant that technique was.
Right.
But it's one variation in this context of this moment that would work. And when someone says to you, what would you do now? Well, it depends. Where's the person? What's happening? Because there's a lot of ways. So, and that's a really good way to put it. I know Tom was talking about training at Sichitong, how important it was as a child coming through to train with all the different trainers, because each one would have a slightly different emphasis or reason for doing something. And if you only stuck with one trainer, you only became sort of a mirror of that trainer with your own little slant. And it takes time to work out who you are and then work out which bits suit your style or against which fighter.
Something that the trainers here have really instilled in me more than, like, more over the years, is there's this word in Thai, tamachat, it means, like, nature. And so they give you the technique, but it's your nature that shapes it. So it's do it how it feels good to you. And so you constantly have to see how a technique feels. If it doesn't feel good, you're not going to use it. So that's not your technique. But then there will be people who, you look at how Paula Radcliffe runs, she has the worst form ever, but she beats people because that's naturally how she runs. If she wants to, like, get really rigid and tight about having proper form, it's going to change how she's expressing herself in the sport that she loves. So I think that the most inspirational part of watching Thai fighters in Thailand is that they're expressing something. And I think that we misunderstand that in the West as being a particular technique, but it's not technical. It's actually relaxation and free form. It's the Thammachat version of that.
Yeah, for sure. And over the time, so now training sort of so intensely for the 6 years that you've been over here, has there been injuries that have set you back, that have taken longer to heal and things than others, or have you had a pretty good run?
My immediate answer is I've never been seriously hurt, but then when I say what my injuries are, people kind of like their mouths open. My nose is currently broken and I fought with it already. My trainer this morning was shoving his hand into it. sucks. So I've had my nose broken now 4 times, 3 of those in training, 1 time in a fight. I've broken my hand, my foot, I have over 100 stitches in my face. And then you just have, you know, like ringworm and staph and things like this. But none of those to me are serious injuries. I train through all of them as long as you're not infecting someone else. I fought with a broken hand, fought with a broken foot. It's the art of 8 limbs. You take one out, you're kind of still okay for most of them. I don't stop for most of the things because for the most part I can train through them. And I find that the benefit from adjusting to your injuries and what you can get out of it and how much technique you can benefit from keeping going instead of sitting at home playing video games with your leg propped up or something, to me is far more meaningful. So I feel like I've been really lucky in that I don't have any serious injuries that have kept me from doing what I'm doing. But I also, like, if I try to think of what that injury would be, I don't know. Maybe it would have to be like a broken leg that...
Yeah, like a knee blowout or something.
Something.
Like that.
Not
yeah, that's never happens. Did you have any fights in America before you came out?
I had 9. I have a really bad record as an amateur. And fighting in America is frustrating. It's an incredibly small fishbowl that people think is the entire ocean because we're Americans. So it's just the like build up to each fight and all the shit talking and all the preparation and all the fighting between gyms and all of these things was just really unpalatable to me. So coming to Thailand where your trainer calls you and they're like, can you fight tonight? And you're like, sure. And you just kind of go, to me is far more in the ethic of fighting that I'm interested in. So I did fight for about, I guess, 2 years. We were home for 2 years trying to save money to come here. So I had my first fight before ever coming to Thailand. I lost my first fight badly. I was really not on the same level as the person that I fought, but I loved it and I just wanted to get immediately back in. And then I had 8 more in the States before coming back here. And it's mainly just like, you know, much bigger kind of 3-round kind of standard Western fighting kind of thing. I think I only had to wear shin pads for 1 of them because New York has different rules, but yeah.
And how many fights do you think before you really felt comfortable in the ring that you could feel what you were doing and listen to your corner well? And
that's still working on it. Yeah. But I guess at around like 30, I started feeling like I was more aware of what was going on. And then at about like 70, I felt like things were kind of slowing down. Probably at like 130, like really recently, I've started being able to like laugh in the ring or realize what's going on and kind of have more of an out-of-body experience of looking at the whole scope of something. But it's people present very different pressure in the ring. Your opponents create a situation of pressure where you can't necessarily access everything that you know until you calm down. So being able to be calm despite the different pressures that your opponent is putting on you is a really, really long process for me. I see people who have like 4 fights who are completely amazing in the ring. They're like totally confident and calm and like accessing things that they've done in the gym and things like this. And for me, that's just a really, really slow process. I'm like working on my 1-2 right now. It's like my main focus.
And we tend to think of the clinch as something that really takes time to just, you've got to do a lot to get used to the feel. So there's no thought in it to work out when to move or when to play with someone. Sort of how long do you feel in your training before you really felt that you were just, you could just automatically do it? There was no concentration on your clinching.
I was in Chiang Mai for the first 2.5 years, and there was no clinching at my gym because they're very conservative up there, and I was pretty much the only woman, and nobody would clinch with me. So one of the reasons we moved from Chiang Mai down to Pattaya was because my gym now has a bunch of young boys who, A, are too young for it to be a problem for them to be clinching with a woman, and 2, they're so young, they don't have a choice. Like, their dad tells them to do it, and they have to do it. And because of my size, that works out to be clinching with teenagers. And just the hours and hours and hours you have to put into getting up off the floor because you're not good at what you're doing, and learning to feel things. Again, it's that slowly relaxing. It's like how when you first start running, you're kind of like tense and trying to like force it, and eventually you just start thinking about your grocery list or whatever the thing is as you're running and you relax into it. It's the same thing with clinching. When I clinch up with someone who's just starting out, it's like a new driver, how they've got their like 10-2 and they're trying to like monitor everything at once. Whereas someone who's been driving for a long time, they didn't do drills to get to where they're at. They've just been driving for a long time. So now you're like one hand on the wheel and like changing the radio and still aware of all of these different things. And so I think that that's how I've progressed in clinching, is just being able to not think so much about like where's my arm, and being tense all the time. You have this relaxation that then explodes from power, and then you go back into relaxation. So again, still a work in progress, but I think that it's just hours and hours and hours of just doing it, and there's no shortcut to it. You just have to do it.
And is there still times in the ring where you pulled something off and you go, oh my God, I just did that?
Yes, yes. Oh, I put Karahat on the ground and was like, I can't over celebrate. But I was like, no matter what happens in my life, I did that one that you probably totally let me do. Yeah, there are moments that I surprise myself, I think, because you expect something to be more difficult than it is, but because you're kind of relaxed in that moment, it kind of slides out. I'm used to fighting people a good 4 or 5 kilos bigger than me all the time. And recently I had a fight with a girl who was about 1 or 2 kilos smaller than me. And when I went to move her, I'm expecting to like, you know, run into the car or whatever. And she's like just this tall beanpole. And when I tripped her, she went like, whoop, boom. And I was like, oh no, you don't need that kind of power for when they're smaller. So it's like, it was a weird adjustment kind of thing. So yeah, that was shocking.
And the Thai culture, a lot of us have been over a lot of times and had good friendships with a lot of Thais, but we also understand that it's different to Western culture, and it also everyone is different. So some people are just like at home, are very easy to get along with. Some people are just generally not good people or are hard to get along with. And how did you find that when you first came over? Was that a learning curve for you to get used to and work out who you wanted to spend time with and things?
There's a difficulty in being a woman in a male sport, in a foreign culture, that just complicates all of that, to not be able to speak generally about what that process would be like for any given person. On top of that, I didn't speak Thai when I first got here, so a lot of it was just going over. And then when I started being able to understand Thai, I realized how much shit was being talked like at all times. And Thais are incredibly funny, but it's, you kind of have to like let, you have to learn how to let the water roll off your back kind of thing. The way a Thai trainer can imitate you to show you what you're doing wrong is merciless. It's hilarious if you can have a good sense of humor about it, but it is mean.
I think most of you
funny.
Experience that. It's
yeah.
Okay,
yeah. And you're like, I don't look like that, do I? And then you're like, I do. But I think that just the same way you would in your own culture, you're drawn to some people and you kind of know that you want to keep distance from other people. And for the most part, I haven't been surprised by personalities like, oh, I thought you were cool and then you turned out not to be. Like, for the most part, people are pretty on the surface how they are, and you know whether you get along with them or not. So I don't think it's been particularly different than it would be in my own culture, other than just coming up against cultural differences across the board that are at times shocking and frustrating as a woman.
Okay, so we'll ask if anyone's got any sort of questions, and we'll field those. And if you haven't, then I'll keep asking stuff.
Because you've done so many fights now, have you thought the same girls repeatedly?
Yes. The girls who I have fought many times, like I have some opponents that I've fought like 13, 14 times. We know each other, like when we see each other, it's the like hi, but we're not like hanging out kind of friends. But for the women who I do know personally and really care for, it is a little bit difficult. I recently had to fight a girl who the promoter promised me I wasn't fighting, and then I was. And I had actually gone to her gym to clinch with her the night before our fight. My neck was like this, and I was like, well, no, but I was there, so I know that she's tired too. Like, I taught her how to get out of my lock the night before. And she had this, she's bigger than me, so she had this really awesome, like, wrenching down. I taught her how when someone grabs your waist, you can use your shoulder to crush them down. And I'm like, and then knee them in the face. And I was thinking about how I had showed her that the day before, and I'm like, okay. So I think that it became a little bit in that fight, it becomes a little bit more like sparring. So you don't pull anything, like you're not trying to not fight, but you definitely don't have the same like, I'm gonna like finish it off kind of thing. It's just a little bit emotionally cloudy, but I definitely don't have a problem hitting my friends in the face. That's what I do all day at the gym. I care about all of my training partners, and we definitely hit each other pretty hard. But I think that the like emotional desire to have them remember that knee or something is absent. So it was a little bit awkward.
Talk about the Petongpong gym.
So this the gym I was training at is Petongpong up in Chiang Mai. It's all female, which does not really exist anywhere else that I know of. And I'm very excited about them because these girls fight all the time, and they hold pads for each other, and they're just like this total female version of a very classic male gym. So every time I go up there, I like to clinch with them because it introduces a different element. You know, they don't clinch with other people, so whatever they know, they all know. And so bringing in someone else, it's different. So not only do I work with them and really care for all of them, but I also politically, as a Westerner, automatically am like, you know, what is this girl doing here kind of thing. So to then also be fighting them politically, I would rather have it be more streamlined because their superstar just turned 14 and she's like 55 kilos, something like that. She's awesome. She's beating up Farong all the time. Dealing with the like gym thing and then the foreigner thing and then people being 14 years old, like there is just like messy. So I'm trying to stay out of that.
So you hit 183, the goal or the point is 200. What happens then?
201. Probably the next day.
So I guess my question is, do you see an end date with this, or you're just willing to just, is there ever a day then you get up and you go, what am I doing?
No. I do know that eventually things are gonna change, and my body's not gonna be able to handle it, or I'm gonna feel differently about it or something. I can't see that right now. Like,
feel good now.
Yeah, I'm so in it, and the process is so valuable and difficult in the future, something that at this moment feels awful. When people ask me, like, what are you gonna do after you fight? To me, it's like, what are you gonna do after you get your heart broken? Like, I don't know, I don't think about it, you know? Like, it's not a happy thought for me, so because it's in the future and I don't have to think about it right now, I don't think about it right now, because I'm very happy doing what I'm doing. But in the 5 years that I've been in Thailand, I've already seen changes in the way that people come over, which to me is absolutely incredible. A lot of people used to come over for like a month and they would save their fight to the very end because they didn't want to be injured, or they thought they had to train up to it, and so it may or may not happen at the end right there, or you may be super dissatisfied with your fight. And I've been writing about how I think you should plan for two, and do one kind of right away, and then you have the other one to either wash the taste out of your mouth, or you're already excited and you want to have another one, or not thinking so much that you have to be ready, like preparing yourself up. And in those 5 years, I see more and more people coming and having two or three fights in the same amount of time, and more women are coming with the idea of fighting rather than like following their boyfriends. So I think that when I think of 200 fights, it's not just the 200 fights, it's what that means overall for what people see as being a possibility, or you know, 30 years from now when some kid comes out here and they're like, yeah, that's Sylvie, she only got 200 fights, like, what a loser, because they're just, you know, in it or something. So I think that thinking about all the things that go along with this already seemingly impossible thing also helps me not even think about what the end of that is, because the end of that is the start of a whole different process of people coming to Thailand. So, yeah.
Sylvie, sorry.
So is there a strategy at all that you're following for the fights that you take? Or do you decline any fights at all? Or is it just, I'll take everyone as a, I can get it as quickly as I can get it?
I don't say no very much. You don't get to 183 by being very picky. I have declined fights that, mostly they're bizarre. Like, right now there's this tendency to have female fight cards where you put full makeup, they're only three rounds, they're televised, they want you to wear these like short shorts, all this stuff. I've done these fights, but it has to be an interesting opponent. So on one where I had to wear like full makeup and they shortened the rounds at the last minute and all of these different things, I was fighting this girl who I really wanted to fight, who's four weight classes bigger than me or something like that. So the fight has to be interesting to make up for those things. I've said no to fights in Japan where like they wouldn't pay to bring a corner for me and that kind of thing. So for the most part, I don't say no. But in terms of like the story arc of is there someone in particular you want to fight or something like that, not usually. When I see them, I usually end up fighting them within 3-4 months, something like that. So
how do you book fights?
When I moved from Chiang Mai, I had to start booking my own fights. So because I was remedial at writing and reading Thai, when I would go to a fight and someone would come up to me and be very excited and they're like, I'm a promoter, I want you to be on my card, I'd get their phone number and basically start harassing them, sending messages, and they'd ask me whether I was available for a fight, and I just have to go. Like, I don't have a corner, I just go, and you find someone there. And usually people will help you, and a lot of times they'll gamble on you and make money off of you, which is really exciting. So I book my own fights, and because we have to travel for them, I try to bundle them up. So when I go to Chiang Mai, I'll have like 3 and 4 nights or something like that to try to pay for that. But it's kind of cool, like being a gunslinger, like going out and booking my own fights and having that much autonomy over who I fight and where I fight and all of these things. And it's definitely not something that I would advise to someone to jump into. Again, it's just like, it's gradually become this. If you just show up at your gym and you're like, I want to book my own fights, they're gonna be like, get the fuck out of here. Go do your thing.
So do you pay for your training then? Or do you still give a percentage of winnings to the gym? Or?
My gym is very unique in that you have to make 10,000 baht before they take anything. And I do not make that almost ever. But I have a arrangement that's kind of like a sponsorship with a residence that I write their blog, so he pays for my training. So I don't pay for my training directly, but I do work for it, kind of thing. But when I was in Chiang Mai, they would take a third, but women don't get paid very much, so that was like 1,000 baht, kind of thing. So I do not live off of my fight earnings. So that's why I do my patron and creating content and stuff like that. So it's actually my talking about and filming and going with these legends and all of these things, that's what supports me being here. And fighting is part of that whole ethic, but I don't support myself with the fighting.
So after 180 fights, surely you got a Ferrari or something like
that. Oh man, I'm rolling in it.
You're like a pro fighter.
Yeah.
You must be like...
I'm like Scrooge McDuck, just yeah. I make it all into one bot pieces.
So it's really, like you were saying before, you're in it for as long as you can, and it's just a burning passion, isn't it? It's not, and you've got to do these other things which you maybe still enjoy, but they're there just so you can get to do the passion that, that is the Thai, the Muay Thai side.
So yeah, there's not much I do that's not somehow related to Muay Thai.
Very cool. Anyone?
No. On a weekly basis with your training, how much would you vary your training and what type of training would you do?
For the most part, I do pretty much the same schedule every day, just in terms of the run and then pad work, bag work, all of this stuff, the different drills that I do. The variation comes from what I'm working on in bag work or in pad work or trying to add in. Right now I'm working on going southpaw. I'm orthodox, but Karahat had me going southpaw, so now I'm just doing everything in that stance, but I have to think about it so much that it's like I've started over. So it's the same. If you look at it on paper, it's the same thing, but in terms of my actual process, it feels very different. But gyms can be a little bit fickle in terms of if the boys have fights, they won't be training with me because they're so much bigger, they're going really hard. So I lose my sparring partners or my clinching partners kind of periodically, which Pattaya is very small and my gym is very socially connected to a lot of them. So I'll go to a different gym and just try to clinch with the boys there or go over here, go over there. I actually met Tom over at Sor Clinmy Gym, which is a friend of my gym, so I'll just move to other places. So that's a little bit of variation just right there and seeing other people. But I'm not, I'm definitely not one of these people that's like leg day and you know, doing 3 days a week is different from something else. Like I'm very consistent in what I'm doing.
Can you give us a sort of idea, your run, how many bag rounds, shadow, pad rounds, clinch rounds, sort of a breakdown like that?
So in the morning, I'm generally running between 7 and 10 kilometers, and then I come home and walk my dogs because I don't train early in the morning when the boys are there. And then I go and I have 4 rounds on the pads. It's 3 rounds of everything, and then the last round is just hands, and that's just my trainer's design, so that's what I do. Then I do 5 times 4-minute rounds on the bag. I'll do probably between 3 and 5 rounds of shadow, working on particular things, and then I'll do like 300 knees. I'll be working on teeps, so maybe like 100 to 200 teeps. Diesel Noi knees in the corner, which go between like 40 to 200, depending on if I've just come back from a fight or not. And then working on particular like balance drills. I was working with Chart Chai, so I'll just be doing this kind of like trying to get my balance, which is a little bit different from my shadow. And then you do conditioning, so that'll be any kind of weights that you're doing or sit-ups or anything like that. And that's the morning. And I go home and I do the whole thing except for the run in the evening with clinching WKO. And sparring. My gym only does pads once a day, so I go to another gym for pads prior to going to the gym I start at in the morning. So that'll be a mix of pads and sparring and then whatever that trainer is yelling at me to do. So I might have an extra 300 teeps on the bag because he's pissed at me or something. So I just move a lot. My weight? I'm smaller than everybody, so I never have to cut weight. I walk around at like 47, 48, and I'm fighting girls 52 to 58. So it's nobody cares. If I have to cut weight, it's very, very rare.
You fight a 10-year-old.
It'll be like I'll cut maybe like 2 or 3 kilos. It's I never do these drastic cuts just because nobody's that small. But I tend to do just kind of like the water cut kind of thing where you load water and just kind of get rid of that, or maybe do a sauna or something like that. So I'm a little bit of a hybrid of a Western version and then what Thais do with like the jacket and running and stuff like that. But because I do it so rarely, I don't have a like assurance of this is how long this is going to take and stuff like that. I've done it like 10 times.
Maybe. Yeah.
In Thailand, it's very common for adults, what we call adults over 18, to fight teenagers. And sometimes when we see it, it can be quite confronting, sort of like, why would a 14-year-old be against a 24-year-old or something? Was that something you had to grapple with in your own head at all, or were you pretty comfortable with that straight up?
Even when I'm fighting someone young, like 15, they tend to be bigger than me.
Yep.
It's it's a little bit weird, but at the same time, they're trying to punch you in the face.
You're
like,
still
they're
strong,
not
right?
kids. So it's, I think that I think I struggled with it at the beginning, but it was so long ago that
yep.
I don't remember. They tend to be college age, the girls that I'm fighting now. So they're, because I'm 33, that's a pretty big age difference, but they're like 18 to 24 kind of thing. So I think that the presence someone has in the ring is by and large what my experience is with them. So I don't see a schoolgirl, I see a girl trying to knee me in the face. So.
And I think if you're coming over to do what you've done here is that you have to be willing to just accept what the cultural norms are of the place, to go in with your own set.
We skew things very differently.
Yeah.
I started at 24, that's like way past retirement age for women here. So for me to be at the level of someone who's been doing it for 8 years, I've been doing it for like 9 years now, to have someone who's also been doing it for 9 years, she's gonna be like 16 years old. So it's something that I think the Western perception and the Thai reality don't always mesh well together, and you just have to decide whether you're gonna fight or not. And I'm more upset by a mismatch in abilities than I am of anything else. So if someone is not able to fight me, I don't care how old they are, that's a shitty match.
Yep.
And I don't want it. So if I can fight someone who's challenging and you know, into that fight, then that makes me happy. Yeah.
Yep. Kelly, you can ask
them. How do you keep your energy level up? We're training twice a day and the community's just killing us.
It's because I do it all the time. You know, like if I had to go run a marathon, I'd be shit. But people who do that all the time, they've trained for it. So it's like, how do you do this? Is they keep doing it. So I think that it's the changeover. You know, it's being in the heat. It's coming to a new environment. It's not understanding what someone's saying to you. It's like trying to do all of these things that create this kind of like exaggeration of everything that would be hard as it is. But these kids who I train with, they run 10 kilometers every morning, and so they think it's the funnest thing in the world to go do these mini marathons, because they do it every day, and they're just like wiping the floor with these people who have been training for it, and they're like, yeah, it's just the morning run, I just do it a little bit faster, and they get to get a trophy. It's like they're like, I got a trophy for it, and I'm like, you did nothing. So I think it's like that. Like, for them, it's really easy, because they do it every day, whereas people who, like, they've done the couch to 5K, they've worked really hard for it, and it's a lot of effort. So the more you do it, the easier it becomes. If I tried to swim, I'm a really shitty swimmer, I'd be like, how do you do that? Like, how do you go 90 feet in a pool without
you do
drowning?
Nap though, very important.
I nap a lot, I sleep a lot. You have to sleep a lot. The first month that I was in Thailand, I don't think I was awake other than training, like for a month probably. I'm real mean to Kevin if I don't get a nap. Like, real mean.
I have another question for you, Sylvie.
Yeah.
I'm not familiar with your technique or your style or anything, but I will be. So, over your journey, can you explain whether or not your technique that you might be known for example, whether you're known for your leg kicks or clinch or whatever, how has that been constant all the way, or has that changed from like 100 fights to now? Like, for example, Sipman Chai is good at their leg kicks and things like that, and
right.
The gym is generally known for that. What are you known for, do you think?
I'm known for clinching and knees.
Yep.
The Muay Siam is the magazine and newspaper for Muay Thai in Thailand. They call me Miss Gangster Knee. That's my nickname, which I'm very proud of. It's not fully a compliment, but it's great. So I'm known for my knees and clinching, which is not really a female style, which I also find really cool. But I've just gotten better at it. Like, that was not initially my style. I think I actually used to be a lot more of a puncher.
Okay.
And now I'm like trying to get my punches to go. It moved. And I think it has developed over a long period of time, but it just kind of shapes itself. People know Ramon Dekker as going southpaw a lot. He did that because he broke his foot. He's not actually southpaw. So people change over time. And I think that it's learning your style is something that happens over and over and over again. And how people were when they were younger versus how people are when they're in their heyday is really different. And I've often, I'll get women writing to me who are really frustrated because they're like, my kick used to be really great and now it's not great. And I'm like, well, what's good now? Because they're not thinking about it. And they're like, oh, well, now my punches are really great. It's like you have a banquet table and you only have so many plates. You never clear anything. Like, you never, you're like, that's great, that's settled. You're just rearranging plates all the time. So, like, your kick goes over here and now all of a sudden you have pretty good knees, and then your knees kind of go over there because you're working on something else. So at the moment, I'm known for, for my knees and clinching, which will probably stay that way for a long time.
This is a tremendous life choice that you've made. Without sort of, I guess, being too intrusive, what does your family think about this, or what do you do?
You should hear Thai people ask me that question. Why don't you have children?
I haven't met any other woman that's doing what you're doing.
Yeah, it was not an all at once decision. I have a bachelor's degree in liberal arts, which technically I'm doing because I'm writing, but it's, you know, like, what was I going to do otherwise? I was a bartender in New York before we stopped and moved here. I'm incredibly lucky in that my husband has been with me in all of this, comes with me, supports me, he helps me with all of the, you know, he understands how to upload a video, whereas I'm like, put it over there. So it's, my family, I think, would support me no matter what I want to do. They were not way into it to begin with. I'm the only woman in my family. I have three older brothers, and they were not ready for me to be like the most badass son of everybody. I think that they grinned and bared it before they actually liked it, and now they're pretty proud. And it's the same thing as that I did not just one day wake up and decide to go live across the world. It was this kind of gradual nodding into that they had to kind of get used to as well. I think they have a really hard time with me being here more than me doing what I do, partially because they can't see the whole picture of what it is that I'm doing. Like, when I explain to my mom the impact that I'm actually having on people who are not me, she gets it. She understands that part, but she does not understand the, like, punching people in the ring part. Whereas my dad is, like, way into the, like, my daughter's doesn't need self-defense classes kind of thing, but, like, could not care less about the writing part. So.
Have they ever come over here, or that's just not in the equation?
My parents have visited a couple of times. My mom just retired, so she's going to be coming out at the end of the summer. I'm trying to get my brothers to come out, but they are in very different places in life. When Thai people ask me why I'm not home, or why I don't miss home, or any of these things, they see it as being that my family was all together and I just extracted myself. But my family is actually pretty scattered across the U.S. I was in New York and the rest of my family is somewhere else, so I didn't see them anyway. So for me, being in New York and not seeing them versus being in Thailand and not seeing them feels a little bit the same. I think the pressure of, like, my brother having babies and me not being able to go visit them and stuff like that is, it's difficult, and I think that saying no to that puts a strain on their understanding of what it is that I'm doing. But overall, I think that just being so passionate about what it is that I'm doing, they cannot help but support that part of it. So if I was even more crazy than I currently am, I think they would still support it. So.
Many of your fights been overseas, as in out of Thailand.
I have one fight, and it's in Laos, so like, okay, 10 hours away.
Yeah.
You know, I stay in Thailand all the time.
And have you had offers from other countries, or?
I have. I don't see a reason to go for the most part, because again, the question of how do I choose fights? Unless it's a really interesting fight, I can't warrant going for 3 days to China to be uncomfortable and fight someone until now and all of these different things. I haven't had something that was super interesting yet, but people are very keen to invite me to, you know, Japan or Australia or something like this for a fight, and they're like, oh, there's, you know, good fighters in this area. I'm like, there's great fighters in Thailand, so I don't know why I'm going, but not yet.
If the purse was enough, would it be enough to turn you, or is it more about the
For
fight?
It to be about money, it would have to be a significant difference. Like, it would have to pay for a year of Thailand or something. Yeah. So money is not really my incentive, or I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. But if it was an interesting fight, I think that would be what I'd be looking at. Yeah.
Are you surprised that a New York promoter or an American promoter hasn't tried to get you back using that you've had so many fights and all that sort of stuff where it doesn't surprise
you
at all?
Muay Thai in America, like, could not, they know they don't have any anything for that kind of draw.
Yeah. And again, the weight thing would be hard to find someone.
I have no idea. It's, they do their own thing with like severe blinders on, so I don't know what their main things are. A lot of people have said when I come back to America, they'd love to have me do like seminars or something like this. So I think that without sounding like a communist, it's the people who are interested in me rather than the promoters. So I think that's the part of people being excited, is it would be people who actually follow what I'm doing, whereas promoters are busy trying to, you know, get the one East Coast guy on their card or something.
Yeah.
There's no way to, people don't put, there's no like YouTube of fighters that you can really look at. People are just kind of very prolific fighters all over the place. So if I have an opponent's name, I can Google her and see if I can get like a profile or any news of her, again, on this Muay Siam kind of thing, like if she's been written about, I can get a little bit of information on her. But for the most part, you just go and see what it's like. And when you go to the center of the ring and tap hands, you try to see whether they're left-handed or right-handed and that kind of thing. You kind of don't even know what's going on until the third round anyway, because the way that fights are fought in Thailand, the first two rounds are kind of meant to play the odds with gamblers and stuff, so they'll act like they're not good at something, and then all of a sudden they're astounding in round three or something like that. So you kind of don't know until you're in it, and matchups make fights. So someone can look really great against one opponent and then not look great against another one, and so what you see on a video is not necessarily what you get at all. So.
Generally doesn't want to watch any footage of fighters that he's going to be fighting either. Yeah, we might. I'll take note of what they're doing so that as a corner I can be prepared in my head for what might be happening, and I'll train him without him knowing for certain skills that I think will help, but he would rather just go and see what the fight is. So as far as he's concerned, if he's prepared, he's prepared. You know, he should be prepared or not.
Yeah. When you have enough fights and when you get kind of to a more, when you're comfortable in your own strengths at that level, you're not going to learn anything from a tape that you're not going to learn in the first 2 minutes of a fight anyway. So you can't prepare for anything other than, like, you know, they like to step to the left or something, in which case, like, how much are you going to prepare for that?
Do you ever go in and try and push those first two rounds? Like, just go,
I'm
just going to smash
all
it.
All the time. I knocked this girl out in round four pretty recently, and my friend Emma was like, is that your thing? And I didn't notice that I have a lot of round four knockouts, and that's the you've not been running round for me.
Yep.
So if I push people early when they want to have their kind of rounds off, then the later rounds are easier for me, because I'm the energizer bunny for the most part. But I think that for a long time I've been making up for my lack of experience. I have 183 fights in 5 years. To say my lack of experience, I'm going against people with more experience than me. My lack of experience or skill, I've been able to use my cardio or my strength or any of these things to kind of make up for that, and now I'm not having to do that as much because I'm more experienced and more skilled and able to kind of work more in different areas of the fight. But I think I was at 100 fights before I understood how to fight a fifth round.
Fifth round is very difficult. Ooh.
Yeah.
Even now,
in my last fight, I had to dance off the entire fifth round, which is really hard to do because you have to stay away from someone the entire time and basically just be stepping off and teeping, which is not my thing. If I could do that in the last 30 seconds, I'd be fine, but I had to do it for the entire round, and I basically just got like slammed in my broken nose for like 2 minutes.
What was the reason for doing that?
The narrative of fighting in Thailand is that if you already have a lead, you basically are just trying to protect it in the later rounds. In the West, we get really confused watching Thai fights because we think that aggression is like the end-all be-all. So to see someone going backwards in round five, you're like, oh, they don't want to engage, but they're actually protecting their lead. So I had built a lead to the point where if I kept coming forward, I would either have to just maul this girl in round five as like, this is my end thing. But you end up looking a little bit desperate at times. So my corner was telling me you need to stay away. And it's basically just a, it's partially how you tell the story of a fight of like, I don't even need to mess with you anymore. But at the same time, because people hear fights so often, you actually don't want to like overkill in a fight. Whereas, you know, the more blood, the better in Western fights. Like
anyone who saw Tom's eight man when he first came to Australia 4 years ago, that's what happened in the last round was, Tom was staying back because we thought he had a comfortable lead. The other guy wasn't moving much forward because he didn't want to get cut. And, you know, both were sort of just playing it out as they would in Thailand. Both were Thai fighters. And the judging went against us because...
they didn't know.
Yeah, because they didn't know. And, you know, it was... you know, when you, even for me watching it back, it could have gone either way. Yeah. But we felt that the other guy clearly knew that he'd been beaten.
Yeah.
And we felt that we clearly knew that we were winning, so it wasn't such a thing. And it's been something Tom's really had to change is that fifth round in the West is that that's where he has to come out strongest because every round is judged exactly the same in the West and not on this scale.
Yes. At my last fight, there was this kid who fought after me and he won every round. But then going into the fifth, his opponent tripped him and put him into the ropes and like stood over him. It was super dominant and the crowd went crazy. And he's like 12 or something, and so he wanted to get the guy back. So that's fine, you can go and smash him, but then you need to dance off. You need to be like, all right, I made it even, and now you have to come and get me. And he didn't do that. And his corner was like, stop, like you've already won, and he didn't listen to them, and he kept going, and he ended up losing the fight, which anywhere else in the world he would have won completely. But here it was this like, he lost it by getting Jairon in that moment and like following him. And it was... it was very unfortunate, but you could see how the way that people move backwards or the way that people move forward changes in interpretation of watching a fight. So you're doing exactly the same things, but it has a different storyline to it. So you have to feel the overall storyline of a fight.
Like Sylvie said before, the idea is you're fighting all the time, so you're both pros. So although you're trying to win and things, in that last round, if you get to the fifth round and it's a clear winner, there's no need to go in there and keep slicing up your opponent because you know that they've got to keep working and they want to get back into the fight as soon as possible. And if they control themselves and you can control yourself, it's sort of like an unspoken pact, isn't it, to not look after each other, but sort of control how much actually gets done.
But it's also just a like a moral thing that you don't have to like crush your opponent. Like if you're already ahead, it's like the masculine manly thing to do to be like, all right then, like gentleman's bet, like we've kind of like settled this thing, whereas it's kind of like going after someone and just like wah, like drooling and trying to kill someone does not look good here.
In Australia what the crowd really wants, they pay for that blood, you know. And I think even us watching fights here, most of us, like the fight you were just talking about with the boy, would watch that and be really confused. You'd be going, oh, that was rigged, what did the judges do? Because we don't understand that whole philosophy of Buddhism behind it, of that whole story that's getting told in the ring. Has anyone got anything?
They never were in like the Bangkok stadiums. There's debate over whether or not there used to be a separate ring in Lumpini for women, but you will never get people from that era like confirming whether it was or not. I do hope and think that it is just a matter of time before women are able to get in there, but I don't know whether I'll see it. It's one of these things. They built Max Muay Thai here, and it has effectively killed local Muay Thai in the other stadia. So there's like no female Muay Thai in Pasir at the moment, which sucks, but they're building a new stadium that maybe they'll let women in, I'm not sure. But Max Muay Thai is extreme entertainment. Like they know that they're not real Muay Thai, they're only three rounds, so they don't actually have to go through Bangkok for all of the rules and stamps and all of these different things. And they have different rule sets, so the whole like staying back in round three or whatever, in Max you go in that round. It doesn't matter whether you actually land anything, you just have to go. So because they're so outside of like what is traditional Muay Thai, they've actually had to double down on their like no women thing. So you choose a different tradition or a different kind of old school conservative thing to like pin down what the rest of it is. So to not have traditional style Muay Thai, but to be like, but screw women kind of thing is like the way to pin that down.
I didn't have women.
I fought there once, so I am the only female Muay Thai bout with this girl, Mung Sing Ju.
No more women.
No more. That said, and I don't want to sound like I'm not like for women, because I absolutely am. When I watch the female Muay Thai fights that are on TV, they should not be at max. Like, the way women fight does not fit there. There are incredible female fighters that you'll see at like festival fights, and like they're better than the male fights, and they're just so incredible. But when you look at the women who are fighting on like PPTV or all of this stuff, the style that a lot of women try to go for should not be there. Like, it does not fit there. And they would have to completely change that in order for that to be appropriate. So
I think most people who've watched quite a few local Thai type fights would often see that the 15 to sort of 19, 20 year old fights, they tend to be the cleanest and best fights to watch if you're watching from a technical point of view. After that, it seems to develop into the fighter's fight. So if you're just watching like purely because you want to see pure Muay Thai technique, you tend to find that the younger fighters are still finding their way, so they're really, everything's as neat as possible.
Yeah.
When they get older, it's a lot a bit more about the tricking and the stylizing behind it.
Well, you look at Bernard Hopkins, he completely changed his style because he got older, and you can't just like get pummeled all the time, so now he's like super evasive. But when you say older fighter in Thailand, you're not talking very old. I was talking to Atatai Fairtex, who beat Nam Kabuan twice, and Nam Kabuan is just like, he was undefeated for 6 years. He retained his belt at Lumpini for 6 years, which is incredible. And we're like, how did you beat him twice? He was like, oh, he was old already. He was like 26. Old man. Yeah. Very young.
Tom, can you jump up as well, please, man? Oh, it's all right, man. Don't worry about it. Okay. So I was just going to ask Tom a couple of questions about stuff, but so Tom, when you stopped fighting over here, how old were you when you sort of stopped regular fights in Thailand?
When they stopped fighting here?
Yeah.
In maybe 22.
22, so they were feeling like Tom was getting a bit old, and Tom was having trouble cutting weight down to where they wanted him, so they wanted you at 62 and below, was it, Tom? Whereas in Australia, we fight, Tom fights between 63 and a half to 65, general, that sort of thing. He doesn't feel like he has to cut so much. And part of that is because you're fighting Westerners, Tom, you feel like you can be more tricky and evasive because they haven't seen that before.
When now you get older, more very tired, different when you're young, training. When you're young, you still, today you fight, tomorrow you feel still fit, yeah. But when you get older, you fight today and tomorrow, I'm very strong.
Yeah. And so, Sylvie, your record of 180 fights, there would be almost, I can't think of a Thai female that would be over like 80 fights, or is it?
No, there's, if you look at women who are from like Assan, like they grew up doing Muay Thai, so Loma is like my nemesis. She started when she was 8, she's like 24. She has over 200 fights.
Because
When you're little, you fight all the time, she's fighting boys. Like, a lot of people know Petchi Ja as the girl who fought boys, and she's kind of this like phenom. She's actually not unusual in that way. What's unusual about her is she fought boys on TV, and they barred her, she can't do it anymore. So there are entire groups of girls who have like over 200 fights by the time they're 22, 25, that kind of thing. But they do, at that age, completely, there's like a 13, 14 years old that when the body starts to change, they're either gonna keep going with it and kind of transition into like heavy money fights, or they're just gonna get out of it, basically. And right now Loma fights for the Thai national team, so she doesn't fight very often, but she goes and just like wipes the floor with non-Thai people across the world. She does these body throws that are just incredible. But the Thai government subsidizes, like if you win gold for the country, you get
a million
baht or something.
Yeah, wow.
So her family built a house, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like, so this, the prospect of Muay Thai being in the Olympics is something that people are talking about right now because it just got, what's it called?
Provisional
improvement. So it might be in 2024. A lot of people are really poo-pooing that idea because it's going to change Muay Thai and it's going to not look the same and all of this stuff. And like, yes, but for Thai women having that as a possibility, it is a huge difference because women can't fight at Lumpini, women can't fight at Rajadamnern, and you can't be national champion. But for women to go fight and win gold because they're amazing and they've been fighting since they were seven, that's a million baht for your family. So I think it's awesome.
Well, guys, if anyone got anything else they want to ask or add, so that's pretty much our hour. So thank you very, very much for that. So a very big round of applause.